Are you here for Game of Thrones? All right. It is with great pleasure that I introduce three Ians and a Eugene. Let's make some noise. We got one, two, three, and a Eugene.
Hello.
My gosh, there's so many. Hello.
Does this work?
Good morning, good morning.
Mike, sure.
Testing.
Hello.
Testing 1, 2.
Hello. Is this
no, we are not.
Hello. Just me.
Yeah, they work.
I think they're working
Hello.
Now.
Sorry.
If you have questions, please, we have two microphones set up for you to queue up and ask any questions you have. I want to start with a simple question. What was your favorite scene from the last season?
Oh.
Hold the door. It nearly killed me. I thought it was the absolute genius storytelling that is so typical of Game of Thrones. I thought that moment whenever it was revealed to all of us where Hodor's name came from and how his character got to be the way he was absolutely heartbreaking. I thought it was just genius filmmaking, and it was George Martin later said it was one of his three big twists that were still to come in the story. Goodness knows what the next two are going to be. I thought it was just stunning.
I would agree with Ian. I thought, in a personal sense, it was the most touching moment, probably one of the most touching moments in the whole series, actually. But of course, there are a couple of big, spectacular moments, and I'm sure some of the lads will want to talk about it. I mean, see, episodes 9 and 10 both were extraordinary in terms of big scale moments. And I mean, 9 was just unbelievable, really. But in terms of filmmaking, it was unbelievable. But both those final episodes of season 6 were absolutely cracking as far as I was concerned.
I think watching the story as to how the director and the cameraman had to create episode 9 with the number of men they had being soldiers, just the whole thing was so enormously, the scale of it was as big as it looked on screen, and how they managed to get the CGI in place for things like, you know, horses colliding at kind of full speed, breaking, you know, spears breaking, everyone being dismounted. It looked like an absolute nightmare to film, but they somehow managed to do it. I think that was so impressive, so impressive. And the giant in the middle of it as well.
I didn't understand a word that anyone said, but so I might be just repeating what they said. But I think my favorite scene was episode 5, The White Walkers, which was, I think, one of the most extraordinary things I've ever seen on the television. I don't know how they did it. I just thought it was completely brilliant.
I would also say, to echo Ian, I thought episode 9, The Battle of the Bastards, was quite simply the best episode of television I have ever seen of anything. And I hate spoilers, but I will say when I was flying over here on Thursday, I'm over with my family, and two ahead of me in the security queue was Sophie Turner and Maisie Williams. And I hadn't seen them for about a year. And it was really funny because my youngest kept looking at Maisie and just looking at her and saying, "Oh, you killed my dad!" But I congratulated Sophie on episode 9 because I said to her that it was the most stunning thing I'd ever seen. And without giving any spoiler away, her words were, "If you thought episode 9 was good, wait till you get a load of season 7.
It looks like we have a question over here.
Hi, guys.
Hello.
I was just wondering, did you expect your characters to die the way they did or go out with a bang? And if you could have changed the way they went out, what would the setting have been or the character who killed your character?
Right, I'll pick up on that quickly. I didn't expect to go the way I went. In fact, I'd expected to hang around for a lot longer. So, if I'm honest, I wasn't entirely chuffed that I went when I did. At least they gave me a good out, and I felt it was, you know, it was a fight, and we got a chance to see Barristan fighting, and that was good. I just wished for once I'd managed to fight and not end up being killed, but there you go. Funny enough, I've talked to one or two people over the weekend who said, no, it should have been bigger. You should have had a bigger fight. You know, it should have been more glorious again. And I'm beginning to sort of feel, yeah, actually, you're right. It should have been bigger. But anyway, I'm gone. That's that. I'm happy enough now.
I was very lucky to get the death that I did. I was pretty, it was a pretty extreme day having to drag my semi-paralyzed body along the ground for 2 days straight in a cave that's underneath one of the castles outside Belfast. And the entire ground, forgive my French, is covered in batshit. So we were covered in fake blood, I was sweating, and I try dragging your body along a muddy floor when you're soaking wet and not being allowed to move your legs. You don't quite appreciate how much you have to carry. So by the end of it, I was thoroughly exhausted, but that's just the way that they managed to turn it into the music that they used in episode 10, just before, no spoilers, just before, okay, it happened, I will say, was just so powerful on top of the content itself. So I was very lucky to get that. Everyone asks occasionally, were you sad? People ask sometimes, are you sad that your character died? My attitude has always been, literally since episode season one, everyone is going to die. I'm convinced that season seven, everyone, and most of the characters you all know and love will die too. It's not a question of when, it's a question of how. So I got a good how, luckily. If you went another way, I would say, I'd say if Lancel had a chance to spread the faith to the rest of the Seven Kingdoms, dying in a holy crusade wouldn't be too bad. So that would be my second option.
Listen, if you'd done that, I'd have come back and killed you.
Well, my death was pretty funny after all, wasn't it? I found out at the start of season five, but funny enough, I had actually, David Benioff had let it slip to me in season two that Arya was going to kill me. And so I knew for 3 years who was going to be my nemesis. And I'd already got the script for episode four where I get sent to Braavos before David and Dan told me that I was going to be killed. They said it was going to be spectacular. I think it was. I think it was a pretty fabulous death. Great way to go. I was very grateful for it, and I was very, very grateful for the two scenes preceding it, because those scenes were not in the book. And it was like, it was almost like they were written for me as a thank you, and I was very, very appreciative to go the way I went. I thought it was a fantastic exit. If you're going to go in this show, go like that. How would I like to have died? I don't really care, just as long as it was season 8, episode 5. Because leaving this show was one of the worst moments of my professional career. It's like being part of, and I will tell you all, one of the reasons why this show is so incredibly good is because everybody associated with it, from the top of the pyramid to the base of the pyramid, does such a fantastic, incredible job. The attention to detail, the production values, everything about this. Everybody associated with this show is so incredibly passionate about it. With the result that over the seasons, you become part of this family. That's the only way I can describe it. It's a family, and everybody knows everybody else. Everybody's working for the same objectives. And when you die, it's like being told you can't go back to your family again. It's awful.
Yeah, I totally agree with all that. I think first thing to say is I was amazed I survived as long as I did, really. to get, I think I did four seasons, and every season I counted my blessings that I was still there. But my death was kind of a roller coaster, because you get the phone call at the beginning of a season from Dan and David, the creators, to say, sorry, but this is it. This is your last season. They do that for you, which is very nice. And I went, okay, well, that's great. I've lasted this long. That's pretty good. And so I went in to start filming the beginning of that season, and I bumped into one of the executive producers who said, hello, lovely to have you back. And I said, oh, it's lovely to be back. Not for long, I know, but it's nice to be back. And he said, oh, no, what do you mean? No, you're still here. You're still there. You survived this. And I said, no, I don't think so. The scripts say I die. The scripts say I get blown up. And he said, no, I know you're still there. He said, no, you're down under the crypt with your son, with Lancel. And I went, oh, fantastic. Well,
where were you?
Yeah, and I
Dad.
So I said, are you sure? Are you sure about this? Because it's not what it says in my scripts. And he suddenly went, oh, God, oh, I'm sorry, no, that's right, we've rewritten it. No, you do die.
Oh, that's so bad. Oh, yeah. That's so awful.
So that was a bit of a roller coaster. And then finally, the other thing is, I mean, I was very happy to die in that scene because, again, another extraordinary piece of television, but it didn't follow the books, and I did know how I should have died, and as I'm sure you all know that know the books, I should have been killed with a crossbow by Varys, but that wasn't to be, because in fact I never met Varys throughout the, you know, throughout the whole run of the show, and they needed to cull a whole load of us in one go, and that's what they did, and that was my death. But I'm very glad to have survived it that long.
But I would say it was quite a funny thing in that episode, in that scene. The whole inside the set of Baelor, there was a moment that before Lancel goes away, and for reasons that I don't think anyone fully understands, follows a little boy onto the set. We won't talk about that. Ian and I were trying to find a moment when we could have some sort of acknowledgement of just the briefest of eye contact to at least be aware of one another whilst this trial is taking place, when Loras is having the carving put into his forehead. And it was the last chance that we sort of had, because the only time that Lancel and Kevan really see one another is at the start of episode season 5, when you see Lancel come back as a sparrow for the first time. Most of whom didn't know who the hell I was. They thought I was just some punter who came in with a weird haircut. But it was funny, that scene, because it felt, I thought at least, it felt as sort of the gravity of it, the magnetism of it felt as strong as it was in reality as it was on screen, because we were trying to get this moment. But sadly, we couldn't get it in because there was so much to do. But still, we were looking for it.
Yeah. That is odd. That is odd in Game of Thrones, that you very often don't meet your nearest and dearest.
Yes, no.
And we very rarely did, yeah, those two occasions.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, I want to know, Eugene, how long did it take to get the thing put on your head? Because I assume, based on your head now, they did not burn it into your head.
I have a fantastic cosmetic surgeon who has been really doing great job work. No, they took a whole, it's a bit of an overreaction for them. They took a whole cast of my head. I was inside, like Mrs. Doubtfire, like Robin Williams' Mrs. Doubtfire. My entire head was sealed. So I was sort of sat on this chair, couldn't see, couldn't hear, couldn't hardly breathe, going whilst they took a full mold. And once they took it off, they didn't tell me why. Once they took it off, I then thought to myself on the car journey back, have they just taken a cast of my head? Because at some point they're going to tell me my head gets cut off. So I thought, oh my God, I've just been given a death sentence. So, but it, all they did was put my whole head in the car so they had it to spare just in case, and then got my forehead, created the mold, put them into high production, and had just dozens of them. And they are basically just disc-shaped bits of flesh that you put on, and it takes about an hour and a half, and that's sort of it. But the thing about it is you forget they're there, because you just forget. Only when you start sweating do they sort of become loose. But I forget they're there, so I would kept walking past people on set, and they would go every so often. It's actually quite easy. I have a fairly easy outfit. I put on my pajamas, I put on my chains, I put on my headpiece, and I go to work. Most people have armor and Kevlar and swords. No, I'm a man of simple fashions.
Excellent. Let's take it over here.
Hello. I was wondering if you think that Littlefinger is only using Robert Aaron for his power, or that there is something to the theory that he is in fact his father.
Oh, I see. They're wondering if they if
Do you think
wondering
if Littlefinger yeah. is actually the father of
the Aaron boy.
The Aaron boy. Sorry, I call him something else, and so I couldn't remember his name.
They're wondering if Littlefinger is the father of the Aaron boy, who is a bit of a weed.
No, I don't think so. I really don't think so. And the reason why I don't think Littlefinger is his father is the final scene between Littlefinger and Caitlin's sister, Lisa's character.
Yes, I can't remember.
Lisa Aaron.
Yes, Lisa Aaron.
That final scene, if Littlefinger was his father, some reference would have been made. Some reference would have been made by her before he pitches her out the hole. And there was nothing.
Yeah.
There was no indication whatsoever that he was the father of the child. His particularly cruel words to her as he pitches her out of the the veil was another one of those heart-wrenching moments that just made you hate Littlefinger a little bit more. But I've never seen any evidence that he would be the father. I do strongly believe he isn't finished with the child. He will use the child, and he will use the child's nature to his own purposes, as he uses everything else to his own purposes. I worry about Littlefinger. I really do. I'm worried if he's one of George Martin's twists. If you see in the very last scene of the very last show, there's Littlefinger on the Iron Throne. I really worry about that.
No, I don't think Littlefinger really should be the father to anybody. He's downright devious, and the idea that he could produce somebody who's equally devious is just horrendous. I mean, with luck, Littlefinger will disappear from the equation fairly soon, because he's an arch manipulator. But, you know, he'll probably survive to the final series, but he's got to go. He's got to go.
Thank you. We'll take it over here.
Hello. Just wanted to ask, do you think any house has the power to completely rule the Seven Kingdoms, or do you think the White Walkers are going to come down and run everyone over?
Can you repeat the question closer to the mic, please?
Sorry. Do you think any of the houses have the power to completely rule the Seven Kingdoms, or do you think the White Walkers are just going to come down and wipe everyone out?
I would say, in short, no. I don't think the land. I don't. If you had an alliance going on between different houses, I don't think they could even really pull it off, because none of them really are fully accepting what they're dealing with when it comes to the White Walkers. There's the whole kingdom is defined by it being just antagonistic and separated and divided. Really, it's never been one kingdom, even though it's supposed to be. I think even if Daenerys were to come back and that whole some people's fantasies about the Targaryens being all powerful again were to happen, you've still got this global warming-esque issue with the White Walkers. So I don't think they do. I think the question for season 7 is whether or not any of them have the ability to be able to unify in time and recognize just how serious the situation is.
I think the way things are shaping, if Tyrion, Daenerys, and Jon Snow all end up sort of like still being around at the end, some sort of unity of those three would ensure that there is some way in which Westeros can be governed. But probably no one house has got that authority, or no one house would be allowed that authority. But the White Walker certainly won't be the answer, I don't think.
I think, the White Walkers, it's amazing, the allegory that George Martin has produced, all these nations squabbling with each other, and there's something endangering the entire planet, or the entire kingdom of Westeros, all seven kingdoms. So the White Walkers are coming. As Sir Davos put it, the dead are coming, make no mistake. I think the dragons are needed. The dragons will be key in any potential defeat of the White Walkers. I think the dragons will be vital. And I keep going back to what happened to Bran in the last episode of season 4. It's something that has stayed with me. He meets the Three-Eyed Raven for the first time, and he said, "Will I walk again?" And the Three-Eyed Raven says, "No, but you will fly." I think Bran's going to take the dragons. That's always stayed with me.
Or join with them.
To help control them, to help defeat the White Walkers. It's a theory I have, I don't know. This is Game of Thrones. I mean, anything could happen. But I do think that the houses will have to band together to defeat what is coming, if it can be defeated at all. And if they don't band together, then it will not be defeated. Who can band the houses together? Your guess is as good as mine, but I'm pretty certain it's not Cersei Lannister.
Thank you. Yes.
Hi there. I'm just sort of wondering how rigorous the combat training was before each episode or whatever.
Sorry, mate. Say that again.
How rigorous the combat training was before the episodes.
How How rigorous was your combat training?
How real?
How rigorous was combat training?
You're working with the best stunt guys in the world. Their job is to make you look good. That's what their job is. And they're very, very good at it. I never actually had much fighting to do. I killed a few unarmed people was all I did. But certainly in terms of the final scene I had with Maisie, we went through quite a rigorous process where we practiced what we were going to do under the auspices of the stunt people. Ian would probably be the best one of all to answer that because he was the one, I think, of all of us who had a pretty big fight scene.
Yeah, in my case, every single harpy was a stunt guy. So everybody that I was fighting, they all wore these masks, but each and every one of them was one of the stunt team. So whenever I joined them, they all knew already, they'd already practiced what they were supposed to do with the stunt coordinator. So all they really had to do was to fit me into it. So on a number of occasions, I would turn up and we would just have a stunt rehearsal where we would work through my moves. And initially you do it, you know, very A, B, C, you know, until you get it more pat, and then you speed it up a bit. But you never really do it full speed, A, because it might be a bit risky, and B, because if it's too quick, the camera doesn't really catch it anyway. I mean, the camera's sort of deceptive that way. You can do it at a measured pace, and it will still read fast. And basically, that particular sequence we did in two parts, because for part of the fight, Barristan is in charge and is taking people out. And then there comes a point where he gets kind of kicked against the wall. And from that point onwards, they are taking over. They're in charge. So we rehearsed, because we knew when we came to shoot it, we would actually shoot it in two parts. We would rehearse the sequence where Barristan's in charge and get that pat. And then we would rehearse the sequence where he's at the receiving end of things and get that pat. And then when we came to the day of shooting, that's how we did it. We actually shot it in two halves, you know. So all you had to remember from my point of view was the first half of the sequence each time, you know. But it's amazing, actually, when they all know what they're doing, the amount of rehearsal time involved is less than you might think. Touch wood, it all worked out okay on the day and nobody got hurt.
But I just want to give you guys a perspective of scale when it comes to some of the fight sequences that we do on Thrones. I want all of you to try and imagine, I want you to take the number of people in this room sat down. Half of you can wear Lannister armor, the other half can wear Baratheon armor. When we were doing the Battle of Blackwater, just outside Belfast, we had this many number of people as supporting artists, dressed as soldiers. And over the course of 5 days before we did these night shoots, when King's Landing is being attacked, the stuntmen had given each and every single one of you, hypothetically speaking, a choreographed fight. So the Lannisters in this room would go down and meet the Baratheons, and all of you wouldn't meet and then fight and not know what you were doing. You would have had time spent to actually get yourselves ready to have a choreographed fight. That's how much time they spent before we even started to film. So when we came out of those gates and the Hound was in front of me and everyone was covered in blood, we had all come out onto a proper battle that had been fully choreographed. So for the whole 5 days, that's what it looked like. It was a true battle. And the amount of devotion, the amount of time they give to doing that is absolutely extraordinary. I still actually remember the moves I was given when I come down and meet my Baratheon guy before I get shot by the arrow. So the amount of time they devote to it, guys, is unparalleled. It's really incredible.
I think depending on how specialist the fighting is too, because I'd arrive in Belfast to film and I'd meet actors that I know from other jobs. And I'd say, are you filming tomorrow? And they'd go, no, I'm here training. And there was a lot of that did go on. If you were doing really specialist fighting, you would be in Belfast for a good week training before you even went anywhere near the cameras. So it's really, they do it properly. They do it properly.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Take it over here.
To be honest, I'd like to spend about 4 hours with Barristan Selmy asking who he could fight.
Sorry. Closer to the mic, please.
Closer to the mic.
Sorry. I'd like to spend about 4 hours talking to Sir Barristan about who he'd like to fight and why, especially Oberyn or the Mountain. But to include all four of you, in an ideal world and the worst possible world, from all seasons, who would you most and least like to see end up on the Iron Throne? If it started now, you could pick any character who you wouldn't want to be on there at the end and who you would love to be on there at the end.
Who I wouldn't want is Ramsay Bolton under any circumstances whatsoever. There are quite a few people I would be happy to see on the Iron Throne, but I think the one, honestly, and it's not going to happen, but the one who would be best would be Varys.
Varys?
Yeah. I think Varys would be the one who could run the kingdom.
I agree.
And he would do so to the fairness of the citizens, of all citizens. He would run a just kingdom. It's never going to happen. Varys is going to be behind the throne. He's never going to be on the throne. So my worst is Ramsay and my best is Varys.
Oh, I don't know that I could agree with that.
You never agree with me on anything.
I actually think that the person who would probably satisfy most of us most in terms of ending up on the throne is probably Tyrion. And if I think if you said Tyrion, most people would say, I'll buy that. Whereas if you say anybody else, they might be a little bit more leery. And it's possible because I'm not convinced yet that Tyrion might not be a Targaryen. I'm not quite sure how we're going to find that out, but it wouldn't surprise me if at some point we discover actually Tyrion's a Targaryen.
We were just saying you've gone. You're out there.
He said it.
You're done. You're nuts.
I heard that.
It was you.
I heard that, but he thinks I'm in need of tablets all the time, so I wouldn't worry too much about that. But that's a possibility. And in terms of devious, I couldn't possibly have Cersei on the throne. I couldn't possibly have Littlefinger on the throne. And they're both, you know, manipulative enough that that could happen. But no, Tyrion might be a good compromise, given that, you know, otherwise it's going to be a battle between Jon Snow and Daenerys, and nobody can make up their mind. So something strange is going to happen. Wait and see.
The best to be on the throne, I agree, would be Varys. He's an idealist. He's very politically minded, and he really wants the people to prosper. So definitely Varys, in my opinion. More than Tyrion in some ways, because I just think he's more acceptable to the populace, just unfortunately. And the worst person would be the one that we got, Cersei. The bitch.
I'd agree with that. But I think, as a romantic, I think Jon Snow, although I don't think it's going to happen. But
I don't think there's going to be an Iron Throne by the end of season 7. Sorry, it's just me thinking out loud.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Well, I mean, they did bring him back, so it does beg the question, why? Except that perhaps he eats it, you know.
Well, exactly, yeah. Jesus Christ.
I now really like the idea that the Iron Throne just gets blown up, and we go, great, now we have these people ruling. Because I know that previously we talked here on the stage about how only one person can sit in the throne. So if we blow up the throne, then we have Jon, Tyrion, and Daenerys together.
Yeah, I like
it. I heard a very, very interesting theory about the Iron Throne. I can't remember who said it, but it was along the lines of how much Valyrian steel is in the Iron Throne. And if there's some Valyrian steel in the Iron Throne, it could be needed to fight the White Walkers. So they might just melt it down. I kind of like that idea.
The correct answer is Hodor, by the way, for both.
Thank you. We're taking it over here.
Hello, my dears. When you would be still alive, what your character would be do when the White Walkers or the dragons come, and what your family members would do.
So what would we do when the White Walkers and the dragons arrive?
If
you were still alive. What would they do if they were still... Oh, God.
Jeez.
If my character was still alive, he would be beside Cersei Lannister. Whatever came, whatever happened, he would be beside Cersei Lannister, because it was the only positive thing I ever found about the man was his loyalty to Cersei in particular. Not to the Lannisters, to Cersei. So my character would be beside Cersei to the end.
Well, if the dragon, I mean, if the White Walkers arrive, Lancel would probably still be taking orders from the High Sparrow, who hypothetically we're going to say is still alive too. So I would say that Lancel would probably, he'd probably have to turn himself into a soldier. He'd probably have to do what he could to fight the White Walkers if they came to King's Landing. But to be honest with you, he'd probably end up as White Walker Lancel, which would be an interesting one. If the dragons arrived, again, he's religious, and he specifically doesn't have devotion to a house anymore. So like she would arrive and he would say, "I'm a Lannister. I've got to defend my house." No, he would probably take. He might even be satisfied about it, because it would mean that Cersei would get her just desserts. So I think he would probably either die fighting the White Walkers, turn into one of them, or he would temporarily be on the side of the Targaryens to get rid of Cersei.
I think as a pragmatist, Kevin, or Kevan, as I like to call him, would probably bury his feelings against Cersei. I think he would do everything. I mean, and he already has been seen to do that. He's already been seen to listen to Cersei as much as he loathes her in certain areas. I think as head of the army, he would feel it incumbent upon him to raise as many troops as possible from wherever he could, and he would go to it. He's a pragmatist. He would do everything to fight both the White Walkers and the dragons.
Yeah, I'd be loyal to Daenerys and have to follow her lead, which probably means I'd end up fighting against the White Walkers and probably die in that context.
Awesome, thank you. We'll take it over here.
If all of your characters had to fight each other, who would kill who, and who do you think would be the winner?
Well, I would listen. I think, you know, you don't have to go any further than Barristan, really. I mean, he find a sword in Westeros. These three are pups by comparison. I think I'd wipe them all out, and I would take out both Lancel and Sir Meryn with absolute pleasure.
Well, I would Sir have Kevin's to say,
more,
I mean,
it's a bit more difficult now when it comes to Sir Kevan, because
I would have to say Sir Meryn had armor and a big fucking sword, so I would certainly be able to dispatch Lancel and Kevan quite quickly. Yes, I think Barristan would take Sir Meryn. I think Barristan would be the winner at the end.
I'm just still shaking the idea of Lancel having to look at his father and having to try to decide whether or not to cudgel him to death. That's all. I'm just locked in the emotion of this situation. That's all I'm feeling. So, no, he's got the gods on his side, so a lot of you are screwed, frankly.
I'd probably get rid of the High Sparrow for what he's done to my son, because, you know, although what you've just said, you know, I'm very fond of Lancel. I think he's really gone down the wrong path. I can't quite believe what I did, how badly I brought him up. But I do blame the High Sparrow, and I'd have a good go at him.
Aw, that's so romantic. Thank you. Yeah.
Hi,
Before you ask your question, I just have to say that's fantastic cosplay, and you're a great Queen of Thorns. Ah, very good.
Thank you very much.
Diana Rigg would be very proud.
Many big houses don't have many living family members. So which house do you think would be the first to go extinct?
Whoa. Mine, I believe. The Trant household is no more.
I say big.
Oh, okay.
You've never
you
been better.
You really are the Queen of Thorns, you've never, aren't you?
You've never been quicker, Queen of Thorns. You've never been quicker. I think the Lannisters would be the first to go.
Yeah.
I think everyone hates them. You know? Everyone hates them. I wonder how many members of the family have not been yet with a, met within the Lannister household. I often wonder I think Lancel is supposed to have brothers. He's supposed to have Willem and another brother.
Actually, the Baratheon house has gone.
Am I right? Yeah.
I mean, the Baratheon house, strictly speaking, is no more.
Well, unless we can... Gendry's gone, hasn't he? Right, Gendry's gone.
No, he's not dead. I think the Lannisters would probably go...
Yeah, do we know of any Baratheons that are Robert's kids who are still out there somewhere?
Well, Gendry's rowing the world at the moment. Gendry's on the rowing boat at the minute, so Gendry's coming back, I'm sure of it. I mean, you just don't leave him rowing.
But the Baratheons are pretty well, you know, they're on their way out already, you know. The Starks will be the ones who are most likely to survive, I think.
And the Martells, no one's.
Martells,
yeah, nobody cares about the Martells.
Thank you. Excellent question. Yes.
Who do you think is going to kill Cersei? Because obviously the last king was killed by Jaime when the king was going to blow up the whole of King's Landing with wildfire. And she's just blown up the Sept with wildfire. So do you think Jaime is going to kill Cersei, or do you think it's someone else?
Yes, I do. Yeah. I thought that from the moment that Lena took Cersei took the throne. Yeah. And Jaime arrives in to see her sitting on the throne and the look he gives her. But I also remember when Jaime and Bronn were talking, Jaime said that he wanted to die in the arms of the woman he loved. And I think that's what's going to happen.
What, a suicide pact?
I think he's going to kill Cersei and then I think he's going to die, yeah?
Wouldn't that be a Romeo and Juliet for the ages?
No, I actually think if Jaime's going to get his life back, he has to kill Cersei. So rather than die in her arms, he might actually be almost like reinvented, if you like, by killing her.
I was going to say Kevan, and I forgot I'm dead. So.
Thank you. Oh, great, we can just stay over here.
Hi. So if I was in any house, I would be a Lannister, because it's my favourite house. But if you could choose any house to be in, which one and why?
For me, Stark. Absolutely Stark. I mean, I've always felt the Starks are like, should be like the hero characters of the piece. It started with Ned, we lost him, and you still felt it was going to be the Stark family. Bran pushed out the window. The Red Wedding, I mean, they've had so many really negative things happen to them, and we've followed several of the young ones through their stories. Somehow or another, it is going to have to come back to the Starks. I mean, I think they are the standout heroic family of the story.
Yes, but they're evidently sort of cursed, Ian. Why would you want to be a Stark? You're going to end up a White Walker or burnt or killed. Something awful is they're noble, but you're going to end very badly. No, it's just inevitable.
They are fighting against the trials and tribulations that they have faced, and ultimately, because I'm a diehard romantic, they will rise above them.
I would actually probably quite like to be a Tyrell. I think they have a very good life. I think they are political enough and smart enough to play the game without being too culpable. The Lannisters...
Self-serving and self-indulgent.
Yes, but so are the Lannisters. But the Lannisters, you know they're self-serving and self-indulgent and you want to kill them for it. Whereas the Tyrells can get away with it. And also they're rather useful. I think there was a point where Queen of Thorns, wherever you've gone, says that everyone relies on the Tyrells for food because they do lots of trade with the Empire. Sorry, with Westeros. So I'd like to be a Tyrell. Also, Highgarden just sounds great. I can just envision this Babylon of a city, you know, with flowers everywhere and always sunny. You know, if you're going to chill, I think being a Tyrell would not be a bad place to go before you get burnt, killed, or turned into a White Walker.
Well, my character was a Lannister. He was one of the Lannisters. He was loyal to the House of Lannister. If it were up to me, yeah, I'd go for the Starks. I think the Starks are the most just, fairest family, and the ones with probably the most honour.
You wouldn't be a Frey. I like the Freys, they're great.
No, I don't think I'd be a Frey. I wouldn't like to be baked in a pie. So, no. Starks for me.
Starks for me.
Oh, thank you so much. Oh, we're going to take it over here.
Hello. One of the great things about Game of Thrones is the amount of fan theories and guessing which goes on with it. I just wondered, what's your favourite fan theory you've heard of where the story's going?
I'll tell you what the weirdest one was.
Go for it.
There's a lot of great theories. I have some great theories, but the weirdest theory I ever heard was from a girl at a Comic-Con 2 years ago, obviously before season 6, and we found out where Jon Snow came from. This girl was absolutely convinced that Jon Snow's mother was Cersei Lannister. I mean, I just didn't get that. I thought that was really weird. I don't really have a favorite theory because, you know, there's so many different theories on so many different storylines. I'll be really curious to see what happens to Bran as the new three-eyed raven and how much of an impact he's going to have in the wars to come.
Yeah, I have a conviction that Bran is key to this. The whole thing kind of kicked off with him going out the window. And just the way everything is shaping, it does seem to me that he's going to have a big say before it's finished. But there is also the possibility that because nobody could agree on any single one to be the ruler, that the best way for them to finish the series is to take away the question. And the only way to take away the question is destroy the whole bloody lot. And we got dragons out there, so nuclear, who knows?
I always was kept very curious as to the stuff that went on before Robert Baratheon became king. It's nothing specific. It's just that whenever mention of his kids came up and him loving Eddard Stark's sister and all that, and Lyanna, all of that, the whole thing, I just went, none of this is true. As far as I'm concerned, everyone's been shagging everyone, and everyone's child is everyone else's child. I can't trust any of it. So I've never trusted that anyone's son or daughter is actually anyone's son or daughter, because it can always change.
Great, thank you so much. This will be our last question, but before we get to our last question, my favorite theory is that Ser Jorah is going to get with Daenerys. That's what I want, and I'm the only person that wants it.
Bless you.
Hello. This is not about the story exactly.
Sorry, mate, closer
to the mic, yeah.
It's not about the question about the story, but about when you're filming the series. When you're working with special effects, how hard is it to not break out laughing?
Actually, whenever we were working full stop, it was very hard not to break out laughing. And not just special effects. Special effects are quite unusual. I was quite lucky because most of the stuff I did didn't really involve many special effects. They were physical effects. Like, for example, my death scene, there were tubes of blood. So it was really quite technical as to how they did it. But for me, it was fascinating. I really enjoyed that. I didn't do much green screen work, if you like. And that's, you know, a lot of the wall sequences, for example. In the studio in Belfast, the top of the wall is in the studio. And behind it is the biggest green screen in Europe. But when you're that involved in what you're doing, then, you know, you manage to keep it together pretty well. You know, and certainly from what I was led to believe as well, episode 9, the battle in the pit with the dragons. Well, yes, the dragons were CGI'd in. The flames weren't. The flames were coming out of a flamethrower, so I don't think anybody was laughing when that was happening. In terms of laughing on set, Peter Dinklage and Conleth Hill are a double act that should be touring the world as comedians, and they always had people in stitches. Lena was the same, Nikolai, another practical joker, so there was a lot of laughter, but it was intentional. And when the camera said, when the director said action, then everybody got down to business.
I remember when the dragons were small, we had these, you know, full-size small figures in the tent. This is when we were shooting season 3, which was in Morocco. And every so often, they were capable of flying. So every so often, in theory, I mean, they were capable of flying. Every so often, they were supposed to take off and flit from here to there to there. So one of the biggest problems we had was that collectively we had to have a shared eyeline. So there's me, and there's Jorah, and there's Daenerys, and you know, whatever number of us it was, and the dragon's gone. So it's like, where the frig is it? You know, where's the eyeline? We're all sort of like working really hard to try and... So several times we had to shoot it over again, because one was looking here, one was looking there, and one was looking there, you know. So that took a bit of practice. It's just sort of like making sure we were all sharing an eyeline. It's lifting up on this word. It's traveling there through that sentence. It's up there, not, you know. So we all get it past, and we're all looking the right way.
I don't know whether we're allowed to talk about shows other than Game of Thrones, because I didn't have any experience of working with special effects on Game of Thrones. But I did on Torchwood, on Children of Earth, with the 456 alien that arrives on Earth and put in this tank. And we were really excited about this because the talk that went on about what this alien form was going to look like and what it was going to be and how terrifying it was going to be was, you know, really exciting. And we had to wait and we had to wait and we had to wait. We never saw it. We kept hearing about it being built. And when we finally came to do it, we went into the studio and there was this big tank full of swirling smoke. And we had to go for the shot immediately because, you know, they didn't have the time to kind of constantly refill the tank. And so we all stood there, cameras on us, cameras rolling, action, and the smoke cleared and there was the most ridiculous early kind of Doctor Who type monster, which was completely unfrightening, completely kind of cardboard and strings. And we all just, of course, fell about laughing and... they did have to refill the tank and we had to go again and pretend that this cardboard and string monster was the most terrifying thing we'd ever seen.
My experience with special effects was the one I had my last few seconds on Game of Thrones was when I was dragging my body along the ground, that corridor which you see filled with wildfire. Well, two things. First of all, there were no special effects for that corridor because it goes on forever. It looks as though it's the corridor that never ends, but it really is that. It's just a huge catacomb that just it goes on, and they filled it with these barrels that had wildfire in them. And people asked me what was the special effects like on the wildfire effect, and I said that the actual goo that's used to look like you know, the napalm-like wildfire isn't a special effect at all. It's just a very luminescent green sort of liquid, so it looks as real as it is. It's that the colour that you see on screen is the colour it is in real life. But the thing that got me was what the special effects, inverted commas, that had to come into it was just as Lancel crawls and gets just in front of the candle as it's about to catch the wildfire, the engineers had to come in and put in a proper oil flammable liquid on top of the goo to have some sort of proper ignition. So I crawled up to it for the 25th take of the day. I can't tell you how much my shoulders were hurting. It's really difficult to drag yourself all day. And I got there, and we said to everyone, let's just see how this goes. And I got to the edge of it, with it being just here, and someone clicked their fingers to give the cue that it was gonna go off. And I dragged myself forward, and it literally exploded in my face. Up in front of me. I was consumed in front of the camera by flame. And the look on the director's face when we came into the end of this rehearsal, he showed it back to me. My face went from to cut. And my eyebrows got a good talking to from the fire. So it was really real. It was hardly a special effect at all. It's quite a big lack of it. But it was an amazing thing to watch. And that's why when I saw the fire go up from this liquid and watched it change color as it burns from green to blue, I just thought this is going to be a bloody amazing scene. And it was. It was so good. So yes, a lack of special effects, really, actually.
We were saying to quite a few people who've come to see us over the last couple of days that if he'd only blown that candle out, we'd all be in season 7.
There were three of them, man. I couldn't get there in time. I was too busy being dramatically looking at my death.
He had one job.
Yeah, I know.
He had one job. One job and he failed.
One job.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Thank you to the Eans and Eugene. Look in your programs for when they're signing autographs and taking photos. I'm Yael Teagle. Thank you so much.
Thank you.